Hi, everyone. Hello. Hi. Hi. My name is Katina Davidson. I'm the curator of Indigenous Australian art here at Queensland Art Gallery, Gallery of Modern Art. And before we begin any proceedings, I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land here on Kurilpa Point, which is where we are right now. They are countrymen to my grandmother's mob, so I'm a Yuggera woman as well, Western Yuggera. And really just acknowledge that Indigenous, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in this country are our oldest source of visual arts, fine arts, culture and connection in this country. And this history belongs to everyone here, and it's a shared history. And so I want to thank you to everyone for coming and, you know, really being involved and engaged in these narratives, especially this conversation, art and Blaktivism, which I'm very excited about. Another note is that Ruby Wharton sends her apologies. She's on her way back down. She was doing a musical program with other First Nations women through Central Queensland and been on this week-long tour. And she's hit some roadworks around Gingin, unfortunately. And I looked that up on the map. And that's, you know, 4.5-5 hours away from here. So definitely won't get back in time. But yeah, she does send her apologies. I'm sure if... but also, if you do want to hear her speak, she's at every other black rally in Brisbane, so keep your ears peeled. She'll be at those. You can really listen to her in that space as well, in a real, you know, community space. They're doing her passion with her family and our community, the Brisbane Blacks community. So there's many chances to see her speak and perform, because she's also a musician and a rapper. And a beautiful singer. So, joining us here tonight are two incredible artists, Queensland artists, who are part of the exhibition Embodied Knowledge, Queensland Contemporary Art. We have the catalogue down here. And so this exhibition, it's within the galleries here, which have just closed, but it's on until late January, so plenty of time to come back and have a look. And also in this area here, which is our Watermall. And so that exhibition, it's kind of been in, it was in the train for a very long time. So I think we got signed off in 2018, early 2019 for this exhibition, which really surveys Queensland, contemporary Queensland artists from across the entire state. So my colleague, Ellie Butcher, is a curator of contemporary art, who's here. Give us a wave, Ellie. Thank you. We were really fortunate before COVID to go travelling through Southeast Queensland. We also went through kind of coastal central Queensland, up into Cairns and Townsville and Cardwell, and then all the way up to Zenith Cairns or the Torres Strait Islands. And so that research travel that we did kind of culminated in this exhibition with 19 artists and collectives, Indigenous and non-Indigenous artists from really early, not really early, but early career artists through to really senior figures who've really made an impact through teaching in universities and really guiding the practices of many generations of creatives in Queensland. And so Ryan and Megan, we're selected to be part of that exhibition. And so this talk, Art and Blaktivism, is really kind of our programs for the show. So with that kind of preamble out of the way, I might ask both of you to introduce yourselves, because I find it strange when you sit there and you listen to someone and they kind of talk about who you are and, you know, sometimes that changes or the focus that you want to talk about changes. So I would like you both to introduce yourselves, and then, you know, I have some notes of really great shows that you've both worked on as well to maybe add in afterwards. Ryan?
Is this on? Yeah, here we go. Hello, everyone. My name's Ryan Presley. QAGOMA got me doing a talk here. My work's not even here, but let's see how we go.
Okay, there's a reason for that. Thank you, Ryan.
So I'm on the artist in the show. My exchange booth will be up next month. I was born in Alice Springs, and Dad's family's from Moyle River area in Northern Territory, like top end. And yeah, so I've been working like 12 years maybe in the industry. And so this Blood Money booth will be 4 years this year it's been going. And the one coming to Quag will be 2 months, so longest version. Everywhere else it's been like a few days, max a week. So yeah, it'd be cool to see how the long form goes.
Thanks, Ryan. Megan, do you want to introduce yourself? Who's your mob? Where are you from?
Thanks, Katina. Thank you. I just pay my respects to the Yagra people and acknowledge that the river here connects to my country, Quandamooka country. And we have deep, long ancestral connections. And I remember when you and Ellie came over to Manjerba, I had the oysters ready.
And, before I became anaphylactic to oysters, luckily.
But yeah, I'm a visual artist. Started off painting a lot, and last few years, about 6 years, I've been focused on sculptural practice, working with glass, that's the work in this show, oyster shells, cement, and looking at histories, extractive industries on my country.
Thanks, Megan. So I think that it's important to share. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with both of these artist practices, but you know, you both exhibit locally, nationally, but then internationally as well. So I think I just want to talk a little bit about the scope of your practices before we really start to talk about the particular works that are in this show, and then like really dive into some of the ideas about social activism through artwork. You know, what do museums give to activism or social change, and how do these institutions, you know, become vessels, or do they become vessels for social change, and looking at those kinds of ideas. So, you know, with that social change in mind, so Megan, you were the first female Aboriginal artist to be commissioned by the Australian War Memorial in 2018. Do you want to share a little bit about that practice and these aspects of mapping, and then how that links back to this, you know, ongoing body of work of mapping that you've been working on, and the connections back to country?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I thought it was really strange that the War Memorial asked me to be the official war artist, because, you know, I make geopolitical landscapes that assert Indigenous sovereignty and place names, and it's my work's all about First Peoples. So it was quite strange. I was really terrified. I had only 24 hours to answer whether I would go or not, and I wasn't really allowed to ask anyone or tell anyone anything, but I was allowed to make two calls. I called my nan and she said, "Oh, why did they ask you?" And I said, "Yeah, I don't know." And then I asked Ben Quilty, because he'd been over into Afghanistan, and he assured me that everything would be okay, and that it's, you know, once in a lifetime kind of thing. And Nan said the same. So yeah, off I went with the Air Force and stayed in the UAE, and for 2 months lived in both the Australian airbase and the US airbase. All of the work that I made in the end, it took me a long time, it's like the hardest thing I ever did, but in the end I kind of made all the works about this one day where we went up in a KC-30, up the Persian Gulf, up the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, and then kind of sat in a holding pattern for 10 hours in this plane. And so I was looking down at the landscape and, you know, recognising certain geological forms like Mount Sinjar, and the rivers and the mountains at the border of Turkey. So that all those works are actually on show at Ipswich Art Gallery at the moment for a show called Art and Conflict. But yeah, I've used military maps specifically in my work for since the beginning, really, because when I was looking at parish maps, I mean, I didn't want to... I could have painted the landscape and I could have painted country, but it would have been probably romanticised. So I wanted to use colonial documents, like colonial tools of dispossession, like ready-made maps, and I started to use the military maps as a base to kind of deconstruct and decolonise through language and through, you know, talking about climate change, doing that 5 metre sea level rise. That's really what those works were about. And, you know, when it came to those maps for the war memorial, I was really stumped for language. So I focused on the military language that the pilots use for navigation. So there's all these sort of symbols to read the weather or to map the weather and to map, you know, enemies, friendly, unknown. So if you do see the work, there's symbols on them that are military language.
Thanks, Megan. I'll definitely go and check that out. I didn't realise that those works were there. So thank you for that. And still like looking into this international realm or voice, you know, there was the show in Palestine, the Jerusalem show. Ryan, do you want to talk about that or Frontier Imaginaries and, you know, taking that from this Brisbane context and then overseas and maybe a bit about the work that you had in that show?
Yeah, so Frontier Imaginaries was an amazing thing to be a part of. It was part of, like, as what I was able to go to Europe for the first time, like part of that show, and to Jerusalem. And it's never a place I really thought to go, you know. I got to go to Palestine, Israel, Palestine area for 2 weeks, you know, staying in Jerusalem and going through. Megan was there too. Megan was there.
We went to the Dead Sea.
Yeah, we went to the Dead Sea and we went all through like West Bank, Ramallah and Tabor and Hebron. Did you come to Hebron?
No, I didn't go. That was a pretty
full-on trip. Yeah, it was crazy. Like, it's wild to see, like, what's happening there. Because I don't know how much we want to get in the weeds with this, but, you know, the media through, like, just general reporting, like ABC News, whatever, what have you, sort of, I was very ignorant of that area and it sort of seems like this tit-for-tat conflict, but when you go there and I'm just like, whoa, like this is like super colonialism, like going through West Bank and like all the settlements, which are illegal under international law and that, and there's just like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these settlements. And really, like, I can't see a two-state solution being like viable just because of the amount of infiltration into what is meant to be like Palestinian Authority area. Yeah, it was crazy. Like, I just sort of like, this is like Australia 100 years ago or something. Like, that's what it felt like. Like it's all gonna, I mean, I don't want to be cynical, but it just seems like it's all gonna be Israel at one point. So like, yeah, it just eye-opening things for me to experience and have an opinion on for what I've experienced in Australia and like read that through what's happening there. Yeah, so Frontier Imaginaries was like looking at those sort of global dynamics about what happened here in Australia and is happening here in Australia and how that relates to other places in the world.
And whether did you get a chance to speak to local artists or collaborate or have conversations, and you know, what was the kind of comparison to politics here versus there, or you know, other First Nation countries around the world, like Canada or America or New Zealand or otherwhere in the Pacific? I suppose that's a bit of a larger question, but particularly in Jerusalem, like what were the conversations that the artists were having there? Were they similar to here?
Oh, there's like definitely a deep solidarity. I mean, it's really challenging. I mean, in lots of ways, we talk about how to care for each other, because there's not much you can do with that ultra militarized police force on every corner watching the surveillance. You know, like once I figured out how to get to Ramallah, I just went every day because there was no machine guns, and the Palestinian people were beautiful, and it, you know, so we just go and hang out and I guess be ordinary people for a minute, you know. Because otherwise everything else is so in your face. I mean, I made a midden over there, and talking to locals about what to lodge the shells in, and they said, come on, we'll take you to Bethlehem and you can see what's going on there. And there was an artist living there kind of as a resistance, like wasn't leaving. They'd put a highway in and there was a big settlement like over on the hill, and then sort of over this side was all the old olive groves which had been destroyed, and these brothers, like, we just dug up the earth, put it in the bags and went back to Jerusalem. And then I was sifting this earth to make it finer so I could make the midden. And every, say, dual citizen that could live in Jerusalem and Palestine knew where the soil came from. It was it blew me away. Grabbed the earth and smell it and was like, this is the real Palestine. It was so moving. Yeah. What work did you have in that show?
The miniature painting of reworking the St. George icon.
Maybe on that note, like speaking about minerals and going back to places, maybe we could talk about your work in the show, Megan, and just a little bit about... I suppose a lot of people are aware of your work and your use and research in oyster shells. And we've got an oyster shell work in our collection, one of your amazing middens, Reformation. However, the work that we've got in this show was a bit of a departure, and not using concrete or those kind of materials, but glass. So would you like to share how this leap from media kind of came about in Canberra?
Well, all of the work sort of was sparked by stuff going on in community and how my families were dealing with sort of, you know, native title coming in to our community, and we didn't really know what that was going to look like. But one of the things that was going to happen was that the sand mine was going to close. And so this was a difficult kind of topic in the community, because lots of people weren't necessarily opposed to the mine, and lots of elders thought that the mine was better than tourism, because that's the kind of deal. We transitioned from mining into tourism as to keep the economy stable. And, you know, a lot of elders were saying, well, at least the mining company, you know, they put the roads down and they gave us jobs and they built houses and there was stability. Like, the government didn't do any of that. And when tourists come, they just trash the place. They don't pick up the rubbish. They don't care for country. The mining company do care. They do listen. So I was quite perplexed by, you know, what was going on in the community and not really knowing what would happen. And, you know, again, I spoke to my nan and said, oh, what do you think, you know, what's going to happen? And she just laughed and said, oh, well, we were here before the mine and we'll be here after the mine and whatever, you know, it really doesn't matter. You just think too much. So I did get thinking and I thought, oh, well, actually I want to look at extraction, like before the sand mine. So that led me to looking at the desecration of our ancestral middens, the whaling industry, the industry that preceded whaling, which was the dugong industry. So yeah, that's sort of that chapter of practice, sculptural practice in the last 6 years has really been focused on the economics and politics of extraction on Quantumbuka country.
I'm just going to hold up from this book some images. It'll be a little bit hard to see, but to just give you an idea of the work. So it's called The Tide Waits for No One. And so what you're seeing on this page here is a dugong bone, which you found on Minjeriba, North Stradbroke Island, and then it was cast in glass. And within the exhibition, they are kind of positioned on this light box. And so there's 150 of these dugong bones, which are sitting on top of like a black mineral sand under the light box. And so why glass? Where did glass come? So you were just talking about extractive industry. And so on North Stradbroke Island, silica was one of the main minerals that was exported, and silica, you know, being one of the main compounds in glass. But you didn't use glass from the island in making these works, did you? It was recycled television screens.
Yeah, so I guess sort of looking at mass culture, mass consumption, you know, when you came and did the studio visit, I was staying at Pulan Pulan, which is Amity Point. And what started happening when I was there was that, you know, with the tide changing, the water's changing, the current has shifted and it's exposed, it's sort of eroding, it's eating away at the landscape, and all the mangroves around that area are now dead as well from salination with the sea rising. But what I noticed at every low tide was these bones coming up, and I was really curious about them. And one afternoon, my uncle, who's a fisherman, was watching the water, and he asked me if I'd seen the bones, and I said yeah, and that I'd been sort of putting them aside and just thinking about them a lot. And he told me that those bones were from when the Waifellas first came over and married the Aboriginal women, four women, and they set up camp there, and they thought that they would enter a very lucrative industry hunting dugong, but because the oil is medicinal, they'd observed our ancestors using the oil. But it was a very short-lived industry. I think it lasted about 6 years. Because dugongs are like us, they gestate for 9 months, they only have one calf a year, and so it's not really an animal that you can kill on that scale. So they're still endangered now. But yeah, I just thought I'd do something with it. I wanted to sort of make a memorial or remember this. And when I went to the glassworks, I learnt how to cast... what is it? Kiln form glass, and it's, yeah, it's very complicated. It's like bronze, but with glass, and yeah, just there was a whole range of glass I could have used, but the TV screen was sitting there and it was free. So, and I thought conceptually it's really strong and a nice kind of loop to close on that discussion.
Yeah. And because that old TV screen, not the, you know, LCD screens that we have now, but the old, you know, the square boxes which are, you know, as deep as they are wide. Yeah, it's thick, and also there's a lot of lead in that glass, so it can't be recycled for many other uses, which is why there was a surplus of it. Yeah. And so that, you know, keeping in that cycle of sustainability and using materials that are available or, you know, cast aside for, you know, destined to go into landfill. Yeah. I really love that connection and that really, really tight conceptual connection back to the glass, which was mined on the island up until recently, and then looking back into history and the other mining practices or not mining, but extractive practices with the dugongs and the fishing and hunting. I think that's a really brilliant work to kind of bring those industries together and then look toward the future as well. But before we talk a little bit too, before we talk even more about the future, might go back to Ryan's project, which is MIA. It will be here. So the Blood Money Exchange booth, if you want to hold up your analog slides. Thank you. So the Blood Money Exchange booth will be installed within this gallery, actually just in front of the glass behind you. And that will be installed from the 1st of December until end of January. And so this is a project which has been going on for many, many years. 4 years. But also, but before that, also your PhD and looking into looking into all this. So if you could please recite your entire PhD from 2016 to us, that would be excellent. But do you want to talk about maybe looking into that? And then, you know, I've got the publication here, which is an amazing publication. Apparently they've sold out everywhere. My name is in the front cover, so if I see anyone walking out with it, look out. But do you want to talk about, you know, this idea of currency and the figures and, kind of give us an idea, give us a taste.
So back in 2010, I started the paintings, the watercolour paintings, and like large versions of Australian banknotes where I've pulled apart the patterning and the form and replaced all the figures on the nose. So yeah, started 2010 I was sort of like just looking at a $10 note one day, and it had Mary Riby, I think, the poet. And it has a quote of her, one of her famous poems that was really popular in World War, one of the World Wars, I can't remember off the top of my head. And it's, "No foe shall gather our harvest or sit on our stockyard rail." And I just thought that was a really interesting phrase to have on currency in a settler colonial country. Who's the foreigner gathering harvests? And then there's like all the ideas of, so they've got like a cattle train sort of on the work. And like Banjo Patterson on the opposite, and sort of conjuring that sort of Australian history, Australian mythology.
The romanticized stockman.
Yeah. When like, I think I was reading an article not long ago that it's likely that the man from Snowy River was actually inspired by Aboriginal stockmen, I think. I think it was that SBS article or something. You can probably Google that and find that. Yeah, so I wanted to do, I wanted to rework them and look at people like that had been underrepresented or like marginalized in our collective histories. And looking at money as like the quantitative form of dispossession in the country is sort of, it's a, money is like a cultural ideology transplanted here, and there's a level of belief in it or faith in the system that has to exist for it to work, and accepting a whole variety of laws to make it work. And one of the key things that makes money work in a society is the underpinning of violence or threat of violence. So I thought it would be an interesting thing to use, especially since like it's, we're ingrained that money is like, you know, like if you're walking along the footpath, you see $10 note, $50 note on the ground, you're like, I'm getting that, you know, like it's a buzz, you get a hit, like we're programmed with to have positive associations with the form and with the idea. So I wanted to use that with like unpopular ideas, unpopular histories. Growing up, like I remember in high school, and that people would like taunt me and other people that Aboriginal people didn't like fight back against like colonialism and the onslaught, and like just how untrue that was. So I thought it would be a good idea to illustrate some of important resistance leaders that were like symbolic of that struggle from First Fleet onwards, you know. So we've got like, and then looking at parallels with who's on the note. So poet for poet, soldier for warrior, and that sort of thing. Dundalee on the $100 note. A local area resistance figure, Udru Nunukul on the $10 note, and then replacing that with themes and ideas relevant to each of the people. Yeah.
So it's putting these, you know, Indigenous heroes into mainstream circulation, so really kind of giving more visibility to these people and you know, questioning like, who is this person, what do they do, where do they come from, why are they important, who are they?
Yeah.
And so originally they were large scale paintings, like over one meter wide.
Yeah, meter and a half.
Yeah. And so how did they go from being these beautifully detailed large scale watercolors down to actually creating blood money exchange dollars? How did that leap happen?
I did a project with Fiona Foley in 2014, and she wanted to do like she's just coordinating like a temporary public art installation at UQ, and wanted me to use some of the banknote imagery or ideas in like a public space. So I just thought it'd be cool to make them like, to print some off the same size as the actual money circulated currency, and sort of we just adhere them to like a sculptural work. But then I had like these rolls of these adhesives left, and there's like a conference attached, and so I just pulled up to the conference and I had these all in the back, and as people were coming out, I was just hocking them out the back of the car, and just like $5 each for a sticker, and like I made like $500.
I was there, but I missed that part.
Yeah, so I had like $500 in cash from these stickers. And I was like, oh, I think there's something here, like and so eventually I sort of tested it at Tarawarra, the idea, and had a modest... and then, yeah, I thought, oh, you're going to make a lot of money from, like, doing this. And then I was frustrated at the time of, like, art is sort of sequestered within our society, is, like, compartmentalized with its own thing, or seen as, like, elitist and ineffectual, that sort of thing. So, rightly or wrongly. But... So I was one of the idea to, like, how can I sort of activate these ideas and push them on people and be effective for some sort of impact for community. And so that was the best idea I could come up with, is like having an actual exchange booth, and so I had a show at Institute of Modern Art in Fortitude Valley, and was able to like build a proper sort of corporate looking structure and play off all that sort of Travelex imagery, and I sort of like that questioning of like territories and that sort of thing that you see with these cash exchanges in like airports and sort of these transit areas and moving across territories and that sort of thing, territorial spaces, and then getting like high quality double-sided prints, moving away from just the stickers.
We've got some proofs from the actual booth, which are coming. Oh, my God.
And, getting really nice, high-quality, archival nanofilm prints, and playing with the exchange rate that fluctuates day-to-day, hour-to-hour. And then... 100% of the funds so far have gone back to local community organisations. So what's examples?
And you've been able to raise quite a bit of money for these community organisations in each city, haven't you? It's been like tens of thousands of dollars.
Yeah, so in like, it was cool, like in Sydney it was up for 6 or 7 days and I got 36K. In Adelaide, it was cool. For a small city, it was up for 3 days and got over 32K. And where else? Even in Hobart, during all the COVID stuff, it still got 31 in a few days. So it's over $114,000 that is generated.
So you're really putting your money where your mouth is, and it's going straight back into community organisations.
Straight into my bank account. Yeah, yeah. No, so all of it goes to the community stuff, yeah.
And so if, you know, I'm hoping if other cities can get, you know, 30 grand over a 3 day, I'm just hoping, like, imagine what we could get here over 2 months for three local Indigenous community organisations. So they are, do you want to share? Or I can share. They're Murray School, Indigenous School in Acacia Ridge, Sisters Inside, who one of the members is here, an organisation based in West End that works in decarceration strategies for Indigenous women and children and rehabilitation as well. And the other one is Curator College,
Southside Education,
who do really great programs with the Indigenous kids there, hey?
Yeah.
Sure. So those are going to be the three organisations which are going to receive 100% of the profits from the blood money exchange booth when it's here at QAGOMA. So make sure you all come back, please. and, you know, that's really exciting. And I suppose it's a really good segue to talk about, you know, come back to this idea of art and Blaktivism, like giving back to community. What is the definition of activism? What does it mean to be a Black activist? And yeah, like I said, this project here, it's looking at these ideas of currency and exchange and power, but then it's, you know, putting the money right back in the pockets of these organisations that need it most and often get defunded. And then, did you want to add anything to that idea of, you know, do you see your work or this work as activism, or what are your thoughts about that word, or even the museum, because this really sits outside of a museum, this project, it could.
Yeah, I mean, like, activism is sort of advocating for change and whatever scenario you're in, I guess. It was crazy, like, when I first started this work, I just got the little magazine here. It was fresh after Howard got booted and that, and his government were looking at sedition laws and that sort of stuff within Australia. And so I wasn't sure how I'd go, if I get like cease and desist or something from Reserve Bank or whatever, if I'm starting to do this and that. And so I was like looking through all their rules and stuff that I could find. And but then, like, when I was in Sydney at MCA, I was hearing little rumours that Reserve Bank staff were coming in and checking it out. And then it was confirmed by, like, people at the MCA shop emailed me and told me that there'd been a Reserve Bank coming in asking about it. And I was like, oh, okay. It turned out, yeah, they, like, bought a set. They, like, bought a set for a Reserve Bank collection. And then this is a Reserve Bank internal staff magazine. And they put it on show. They put them on show in Martin Place, you know?
Crazy.
And they made an information pamphlet that you can look up on the Reserve Bank website. They've got like a information thing about my work and all the people on the notes, and actually don't shy away from some of the more like confronting topics. So that was a surprise, you know. It was like surprising things for like a, you know, semi-government institution to do.
So and I wonder, like, when we're going to see these in actual rotation.
Yeah. So I'm pressing.
Or are you under embargo and can't say anything at the moment? Just wink.
I'm pressing them. Because like they said, they email me and they, I don't know if I'm sure about that. Yeah, but there's, I'm cooking something up with Reserve Bank.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thanks for sharing.
And I'm bombing them whether they like it or not, because I figured out how they do their emails. How they do their staffing email. So I'm like researching who's the staff there and like hitting them.
At reservebank.gov.
Yeah. Because they name drop some of the staff that are involved in looking at my work here. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to get it.
So now, have you got any more of those cease and desists?
No, they're surprisingly tolerant. So that's why I just got to keep pushing the envelope a bit.
Thanks, Ryan. So Megan, back to your work. You know, we were having a little yarn on the phone yesterday talking about, you know, you've got the dugong bones here, but, you know, oyster shells and oyster farming has been a really big part of your practice for a long time now. And you've taken that recently out of the museum context. Do you want to share how that leap kind of happened?
Well, firstly, I just want to say I can't wait to upgrade my stickers to the proper notes, because they sold out every time, like so quickly. So I'll have to camp up the front overnight.
10 a.m. on the 1st of December.
Great. But, I mean, you know, I think it's really... it's really important for our people when you are raised in community by family and you're around Aboriginal people that, there is, you know, social and cultural responsibilities to each other. There's collective collective thoughts and collective processes all the time in everything. So when you come into art and then start to work in institutions where it's so like hyper individualized, you know, it's confronting and it's also very isolating. So I mean, that's why I love this work so much. And like Ryan, you know, understands, and we've all been sort of around each other for years as well as contemporary Aboriginal artists in this community at QCA down there at Kaya. So, you know, we always talk about this stuff, like what can art do? And, you know, we're very optimistic and positive and feel like it can change the world, you know. And certainly, you know, you get surprised of like how far you can push things sometimes. So, you know, yeah, I guess I became quite exhausted from making sculptures that are static and almost like dead sculptures. And I was thinking, you know, all this concrete and all these shells, and I'm just using, you know, shell waste, and, you know, I'm being clever and, you know, all that as well. But in the end, these are sculptural forms that sit in an institution that are dead objects that are kind of almost like the artifacts that were stolen from, you know, the massacre sites. I mean, it's not that dramatic, but in the future, they sit as holding places, or I guess the institution is the place for the conversation, to bring people in who may not know anything. But meanwhile, we've got our community and our culture that's alive, and we've got things to do, and we don't have very much money, and we don't have very, you know, we're severely under-resourced. So, yeah, it's we're always thinking of ways to benefit the community and bring community into these conversations, because everything that I do isn't mine, it's my community's. There's a collective, you know, ownership. We all belong to the stories that I talk about, you know. Yeah, so with the oysters and extraction and kind of, you know, going, this is so, I don't know, I'm tired of it. It's not really leading to any change. So I wanted to think about, like, talking to my uncle who's got this oyster lease. It's the longest, it's the largest oyster lease connected to Minjeriba, North Stradbroke Island. And it's been in the family, like, right from back when that white fella married, you know, Uncle Ricky's great-great-grandmother. So it's been in the family a really long time. And, you know, our communities don't get a lot of money from the commercial stuff that they run, like the fishing, and the industry and the fisheries is just so intensely regulated and designed for us not to win. So I was thinking, you know, there's got to be a way where I can get a grant, get some art money, and then we can make a living sculpture, and I can make, you know, a cultural object or an artifact that can be planted on country and be protected because it's an artwork and not a commercial functioning farm or like a CSIRO program or a government program. Like, I wanted it to be an artwork, and it's so amazing. Like, they're there. I planted them in, you know, circular formations, not in the lines that the fisheries kind of stipulate. So, yeah, that was really about trying to break through some barriers and actually return these ideas and these things that we develop or we discuss in art context, but bring it to the community for them to benefit from, and for us to sort of, you know, be surprised at what we can get away with, actually. And it's really inspired especially a lot of the older oyster farmers, you know, they just felt so alive again. And because it is a bit radical, what we've done. And, you know, I had one uncle go, you know, all these white fellas, they've got all these leases and they do nothing with them and they're just taking up all this space. Maybe we should, you know, they're only $400 a year. Maybe we should just buy them all out and, like, do these artworks, you know? And he hates art, my uncle. But he loves this, you know? It's really... So, you know, it's sort of breathed a lot of light. It's done what I really wanted it to do, was to return to our culture and to our community and to our place and to a space where we can... be alive and celebrate each other and be with each other. Yeah.
Well, I wasn't planning on this conversation having a definitive answer to the question that was posed at the start, but I think it truly does. So the question that we had was, you know, art can create these really compelling conversations, but when it comes to social, political and environmental justice in Queensland, can art truly make a difference? And I think we've just heard that in both of these instances, I definitely have and will continue to into the future as well. What a positive note.